So let's look in more detail at this first step of the central dogma, transcription. So the first step in the central dogma is transcription. In transcription, what we're doing is we're taking DNA as a template and we're making a copy of a small section of it. Now your genes, which are stored in DNA, are used to determine which proteins and enzymes you are able to make. The DNA is used to make a molecule of RNA. Now one thing that's so important to realize is it's not that DNA is somehow chemically changing and now becoming RNA. Instead, we're making or synthesizing a brand new molecule of RNA based on the DNA template, based on the information that's there on the DNA. So the DNA will still be there after we make this new molecule of RNA. In essence, it's like making a photocopy of one page of the book. The book isn't being destroyed, the book is still there. We just now have a new additional copy of a piece of that information. Now it turns out that there are several types of RNA, all of which play a role in the second process of the central dogma, known as translation. And so we're going to look specifically at making the RNA, that is the DNA message, for the formation of that protein. Now RNA, we'll see, in translation, is used to make proteins. And in that same way, it's not that RNA is somehow chemically being transformed into protein, but it's the information in that RNA that's being used to direct the formation of a new molecule of protein. In this process, again, the RNA is not converted to protein, but it's used to direct the formation of the protein. Three types of RNA that play a role in the central dogma of genetics would be messenger RNA, known as mRNA, and this is going to be the copy of the DNA message. This is going to be the information that's stored in one particular gene or one particular section of the DNA. We're also going to have the transfer RNA, or the tRNA, and this tRNA is going to play the role of being the molecular interpreter. It will help us transition from the nucleic acid language into the language of proteins and amino acids. And then finally, the ribosomal RNA, or the rRNA. And this is a structural component of the ribosomes. Remember, the ribosomes are the sites of protein synthesis, meaning the ribosomes are where translation takes place. This process of making proteins will happen at the ribosomes. And so part of the structural component of that ribosome is rRNA. So looking at this first step of the central dogma, transcription, this is when DNA information is copied into new molecules of RNA. Now another thing I want to emphasize, it's not that there are somehow blank molecules of RNA that this information is copied into. Instead, we're assembling new molecules of RNA, assembling RNA nucleotides together, but in a manner that will be complementary to the DNA template. So in this way, there are actually many similarities between transcription and DNA replication. In both cases, we're using single-stranded DNA as a template. In both cases, we're synthesizing a new nucleic acid that's complementary to the DNA following base pairing rules. In both cases, we are not directly destroying or impacting that template strand of DNA in the process. However, there are some differences. One, in transcription, since we're making RNA, a different enzyme is used. RNA polymerase is used to make these new molecules of RNA. A difference between DNA replication and transcription is that only a small portion of the DNA is copied during transcription, only one gene instead of the entire chromosome in DNA replication. Another thing that's different is the final product that we get. The final product of transcription is single-stranded RNA. This will end up becoming the mRNA molecule that's being made. The DNA started as double-stranded, and when we're done with transcription, it will still be there as a double-stranded molecule. It was only very temporarily opened and read, scanned, to make this new molecule of RNA. In contrast with DNA replication, we start with one double-stranded molecule of DNA, and we end up with two double-stranded molecules of DNA. So to understand this process of transcription, we need to know the different sections or regions of a gene. Now, the gene itself is one small section of the DNA of a chromosome, and there could be hundreds, even thousands of genes on a single chromosome. Now, the sequence at the beginning of the gene that marks where the gene starts, we call that sequence the promoter. This marks the beginning of the gene, and that's actually where RNA polymerase, the enzyme that's going to run transcription, is first going to bind to the DNA. So RNA polymerase binds to the promoter and starts transcribing. The gene. This transcription will continue until RNA polymerase gets to the end of the gene. The DNA sequence at the end of the gene is known as the terminator. So the promoter DNA marks the beginning of the gene. The terminator DNA marks the end of the gene. And so transcription will start at the promoter and will continue on copying the DNA until it gets to the terminator. Here we see a diagram of this process. RNA polymerase is represented by this blue enzyme, and it separates the two strands of DNA. Starting at the promoter, it synthesizes a new strand of RNA complementary to the DNA, and it will continue doing this until it reaches the terminator. Once RNA polymerase gets to the terminator, it releases the DNA, it releases the RNA, and we now have our pre-mRNA product. So let's talk just a bit about what RNA polymerase is doing. So RNA polymerase, as I had mentioned, it starts at the promoter. It binds to that DNA sequence, and it actually separates the two DNA strands. It unwinds the DNA. Now, of those two DNA strands, one of them is going to be read. One of them is going to be used as the template, and we actually call it the template strand. RNA is being made. It is being synthesized. And this process will continue, RNA polymerase moving down the length of the gene until it arrives at the terminator. And this process stops at the terminator. This molecule of RNA that is being made, it will be complementary to the DNA. Now remember, the nucleotides for DNA will be A, T, C, and G, whereas the nucleotides for RNA will be A, U, C, and G. The base pairing rules will be very similar to what we see in DNA. Just keep in mind that RNA does not have the base thymine, it has the base uracil instead. So if there's a G on the DNA template strand, there will be a C on the RNA. Same way, C will go to G. If there's a T on the DNA strand, the complementary base is A, so there will be A on the RNA. However, if there's an A on the DNA strand, the complementary base in the RNA will be U for uracil. In this way, our strand of RNA will be complementary to the DNA template. The RNA molecule that is released after transcription is not a mature molecule of mRNA just yet. It still must be processed. RNA processing involves removing the non-coding introns from the transcript. In the DNA itself, in the section of the gene, there are regions known as introns, which are non-coding, and regions known as exons, which are coding. They contain the information needed to make the protein. The exons are important. The exons need to be kept. The introns need to be removed. And this happens in a process known as RNA processing. So we see at the top of our diagram, our DNA, the region of the gene is made up of introns and exons. When transcription occurs, both introns and exons are copied in that initial RNA product. The non-coding introns, they need to be removed after transcription. This will take place in the nucleus. In fact, the RNA molecule cannot leave the nucleus until RNA processing has occurred. The introns are removed. The exons are then connected together to produce our mature molecule of mRNA. And once we have our mature molecule of mRNA, this is able to leave the nucleus and go into the cytoplasm, where translation can begin. In our next video, we'll talk about the events of translation and what's happening in the actual synthesis of the proteins. See you in the next video.